Hi guys, I'm Tess and welcome back to my YouTube channel. I have wanted to do this particular video on Rekha for the longest time and I didn't want to do kind of a biography video. I wanted to focus on her immense cultural impact, her personal style evolution, and the costumes in her films that have made her so iconic. And I'm kind of glad that I waited because in July 2023, Vogue Arabia released their pictures for their August 2023 issue, and the eternal icon Rekha made an appearance on this cover. It was so thrilling for two reasons. The first is that Rekha is somewhat of a reclusive figure. She does not do many magazine or media interviews at this stage in her life. And the second, I think, is her amazing style. The Vogue Arabia photographs are so regal and beautiful. I think it was so thrilling to kind of see her back on a magazine cover. So to understand the longevity of her career and her immense impact on South Asian pop culture, Rekha's first film as a child actor was in 1958, and her last appearance in a Bollywood film as a leading lady was in 2015. But still today, Pinterest and social media sites and Instagram are filled with stills from her films and the glamorous and bold photoshoots that she did in the past. The reaction to her Vogue Arabia photoshoot cover was an amalgamation of all of these factors. The styling for this Vogue Arabia shoot was done by Manish Mohotra, and it's clear from the article that Rekha herself was the true visionary of this photoshoot. This is what was stated in the Vogue Arabia article. After she agreed, Rekha stunned the team with her dedication and expertise as she immersed herself in the co-creation of the editorial. Styling, makeup, clothes, jewelry, with acute knowledge of camera work, lighting, editing, and every aspect of the production. She had an unwavering admirer in Manish Mohotra, one of India's top designers, to help her realize her sartorial vision for the shoot. Rekha added, "Manish moved heaven and earth to craft my vision into clothes. To have him leave everything and work tirelessly with me like a wise, patient pujari, meaning priest. I couldn't have asked for a better executioner of my dreams." I was also struck by this particular line. "Intuitive, unafraid, majestic. Rekha, India's ultimate actress, remains a beacon of Eastern elegance that will transfix generations to come." And I think that this is so true. They also call her the eternal icon in this article. She has a quality that fascinates every generation and some younger generations that may not even be aware of her films or her impressive body of work will know of her beauty and her style. I knew about the enigma of Rekha before really watching any of her most popular films. When these images from Vogue Arabia were released, there was some conversation online which referenced Rekha's alleged relationship with Hindi film star legend Amitabh Bachchan. And I was frankly quite disappointed in this kind of feedback. It is really so reductive of her role and her cultural impact in South Asian pop culture, be it through her films or her style. And she has been a part of the Hindi film industry for well over 50 years. Yasser Usman stated in a Vogue India 2016 article, "There is more to Rekha than Amitabh Bachchan." And I asked my own Instagram audience, who or what do you associate with the Bollywood actress Rekha the most? The overwhelming response was her style. This video is not going to be a detailed biography on Rekha, but rather a deep dive into the many challenges that she overcame in the Indian film industry, her film roles and the costumes that have become so iconic, her personal style evolution, and her immense cultural impact. In order to gain some insight into her life story, I read this particular unauthorized biography. There are other biographies out there, but I just had access to this one. It's called Rekha, The Untold Story by Yasser Usman. What I found interesting was that Rekha did not sit down with the author of this book, despite him reaching out to her. But the author did state in the book that nothing much would have changed because she is much more reserved and reclusive in this stage of her life. This book sets out information about Rekha that has been in the public domain. Some are factual, but some are definitely sensationalized rumors from the tabloid magazines of the time. It's clear from the book that these stories never really went away and they kind of took on a life of their own. The stage name Rekha is derivative of her government name, Banu Rekha Ganesan. Rekha was born in the 1950s to Pushpavali, a Telugu film actress, and Gemini Ganesan. Her father came to be known as one of the most well-known South Indian stars. Her parents never married, and Rekha, in the 2004 Rendezvous with Simi interview, confirmed the absence of her father throughout her childhood. He stated in many interviews that as a child actor, her family actually became financially dependent on her. She added that she didn't really want to be an actress as a child. She stated in an interview, "It was one of the most frightening phases of my life. I was totally ignorant of the ways of this new world. Guys did try and take advantage of my vulnerability. Why am I even forced to work, deprived of normal things that a child should be doing at my age? Every single day I cried because I had to eat what I didn't like, wear crazy clothes with sequins and stuff poking into my body, was pushed, literally dragged from one studio to another, a terrible thing to do to a 13-year-old child." She added, though, in her 2004 Simi Garawal interview that she has healed from these experiences. Was on record saying that the language barrier was a major source of difficulty for her. In a 1990 Filmfare interview, she stated, "I was called the ugly duckling of Hindi films because of my dark complexion and South Indian features. I used to feel deeply hurt when people compared me with the leading heroines of the time and said I was no match for them. I was determined to make it big." So I have to interject here because she's always been very beautiful, and as a teenager, she was judged so harshly in the Hindi film industry for her weight and for her skin complexion at the time, when she was literally a child. The film industry's beauty standard is Eurocentric beauty standards, and this played into very harsh criticisms of her that were unwarranted. From the book, it's very shocking to read the commentary made by the tabloid magazines at the time. So according to Yasser Usman's book, as a young teenager, Rekha acted in a lot of masala films and was inappropriately branded as a in the press. So this is a quote from the book. "News spread like wildfire in the industry that there was a new South Indian actress in town who did not shy away from bold scenes. Not a single one of her films was ready, but the image of being bold was foisted on her. She was called a kitten, a 14-year-old kitten." Every decade, Bollywood actresses were styled differently based on the trends of the time. So in the 1950s and 1960s, actresses had a more natural look, but in the 1970s, that all changed. The 1970s, the look for Bollywood actresses was more chic, with coiffed hair and styled with elaborate and dramatic makeup. Examples of the actresses of this time would be Sharmila Tagore and Mumtaz. So when Rekha did films during this time, like Elan in the early 70s, that style was in fashion for actresses at that time. Rekha's image in the early part of her career was totally different from the very glamorous image of her that we know today. Her co-star Jayashree T said about her at this time, "At that time, Rekha had no clue about makeup. She totally depended on makeup persons who had no clue what to do with her. She would come to my room and see me applying eyeliner. She was very lonely, and we became good friends." During this time, Rekha has in many interviews maintained that she never took her acting seriously when she was a teenager. Films were just a paycheck to her for her family. And I think an important point to remember about her is that she literally grew up while working in films, and knowing this gives context to her life story. Rekha's personal life, her love life, and her film career have been on the pages of tabloid magazines for years. It didn't matter if they were true or not. The film producers, the magazine editors, and perhaps even the male actor who is the subject of the rumor benefited from this publicity, but the actress, of course, always faced the most scrutiny and disdain from the public. There's also an overwhelming misogyny and sexism that can be identified when reading articles from the past on the topic of Rekha. And while researching this for this video, I found so many salacious headlines that would be completely unacceptable by today's standards in any reputable magazine. This was stated in the Yasser Usman book after the death of her husband. The national obsession with Rekha's love life had overnight morphed into a national hatred for her. She was branded a witch, a heartless man-eater. There was no future for her, it was deemed. She had no major films in hand, and the industry was unanimous that it didn't want her back. Rekha was projected as a symbol of everything that was wrong and unacceptable in Indian society. But like a phoenix, she would rise again, for she had seen this before, been here before. She was an eternal survivor, an eternal fighter. There are some really shocking interviews that Rekha allegedly gave these media houses in the early part of her career, but that image print media created of her never really went away. A lot of these headlines remind me of the 2000s headlines that we would see in Hollywood criticizing celebrities like Britney Spears, and we look back at those times as some of the worst treatment of celebrities in the West. By the mid to late 1970s and 1980s, Rekha's star was steadily rising, and directors have always conceded that Rekha had a natural charm on screen and a talent for acting. The director Gulzar said this about Rekha: "This is the quality of the artist. How do they put on the character? How does he or she clothe himself completely in the given character? She is able to get into the character like a dress." There was a major shift in Rekha's personal style around the mid-1970s when she was around 22 years old. In 1976, Rekha did a film called Do Anjane, and this was monumental for her in terms of her career. This was the first film that she had scenes with her co-star Amitabh Bachchan, and she has openly stated in the past in interviews that his work ethic changed her own kind of laissez-faire attitude towards acting in films. Do Anjane was the first time Rekha earned credibility for her acting. 1976 was really the year of change for Rekha in terms of her image and her style. She became more polished in her makeup application, she lost weight, she started doing yoga, she mastered her diction in Hindi, Urdu, and English, and she started dressing more elegantly and stylishly, and as said in the Yasser Usman book. In the 1970s, makeup men used to follow antiquated and theatrical makeup techniques. Rekha realized that makeup is an extremely crucial part of show business and reportedly decided to go to London to learn the art of makeup at the makeup school there. She also hired Meena Kumari's makeup man, Ram Dada, who worked with her until his death. She reportedly said, "Makeup is an art form. I saw that my features could be enhanced with the right makeup. I had atrocious long eyelashes in Rampur Ka Lakshman 1972. I felt this was not me, but Ram Dada came to my rescue." 2004, Rekha alludes to this kind of thinking. She says, "If there are so many people wanting to sign me and have me in their films, I might as well do some justice to it." So in 1978, Rekha was around 24 years old, and she acted in another significant film for her career titled Kar. And this movie was not really about the glamour of the costumes, but it was definitely beneficial for her and her acting career at that time. In 1978, she did a very serious film like Kar. In the same year, she did this film, Mukaddar Ka Sikandar, proved that glitz and glamour were very much a part of Rekha's persona. In Mukaddar Ka Sikandar, Rekha wore a very iconic electric pink outfit. At this stage, Rekha was 25 years old, and she appeared in this Amitabh Bachchan film. It's one of my favorite looks of her in her film career. She wore this folk style skirt and blouse outfit with oxidized silver earrings and a green dupatta. 1980, at the age of 26, Rekha won her first Filmfare Award for Best Actress for Khoobsurat, where she plays the lead role of Manju. So this film was remade in 2014 with Sonam Kapoor and Fawad Khan. But the signature look of Rekha in this film was modest but memorable. She had a middle part hair with braids. According to the author of 100 iconic Bollywood costumes, her style really looks like it belongs to an every everyday young woman. In many scenes, she wears printed silk saris with modest elbow-length blouses and small hoop or stud earrings. This no-fuss wardrobe enhanced Rekha's measured performance, and you cannot help but fall in love with Manju. The director told Rekha, and there wouldn't be dozens of expensive outfits for her, and Rekha in fact provided many of the outfits at the request of the director. Her look for this character became somewhat of a trend. Oh, I'm now going to talk about one of my favorite songs, film costumes, and moments in Indian film history. This is possibly one of the most iconic roles in Indian cinema, and I cannot stop talking about Umrao Jaan. 1981, Rekha was 27 years old, one of the most important characters in Rekha's filmography. This is Rekha at her most majestic. The movie was based on the Urdu novel Umrao Jaan Ada, and it tells the tragic tale of the courtesan Umrao Jaan, who was sold into the profession as a young girl. And the director Muzaffar Ali took a great interest in the fashion and the styling of this film, and he worked alongside his wife, who is the credited costume designer of this film, Subhashini Ali. The director stated in an interview regarding Rekha's costumes in the film, "The whole journey of Umrao Jaan was really a search of fabrics. Muzaffar said that he sourced the fabrics from Benares with the guidance of the owner of the Indian textiles company. The most iconic look for me is this white anarkali layered with jewelry that Rekha wore in this song. I feel like it's so beautiful. It's magical."
Incredible, amazing, show-stopping, spectacular, never the same, totally unique, completely not ever been done before.
To create this vision, there was a mix of sourced jewelry and Rekha's own personal collection. Rekha was again known for adding her own pieces to perfect the look of the characters that she plays in her films. And the director said this about this song, "I'm so driven by poetry. So the poetry of clothes and the poetry of characters is integrated into a cinematic statement." According to the book by Yasser Usman, Rekha and Muzaffar also disagreed on aspects regarding the costumes of the film. And the director reportedly said, "Film is made at many levels, on the level of music, level of lifestyle, of clothing. We faced much difficulty on the level of clothing. She carried a whole tribe of people for makeup and costume, and I did not like this." And reportedly, before every scene, her costume team would present options to the director, which he would reject. And he stated in interviews, "They wanted to turn Rekha into a Bollywood doll. The character was Lucknow and its culture. Her designer would always be standing with costumes on a hanger. That she had taken the character elsewhere. They were occupied with making it Mukaddar Ka Sikandar." So after creative discussions and critical engagement, the director and his leading lady were finally on the same page. Highlight of Umrao Jaan was the mudra, or the courtesan dance. And at the time, Rekha had no formal training in Kathak. If you are enjoying this video, don't forget to like it, share it with someone if you really care, and subscribe to the channel. Silsila is perhaps one of the most talked about and sensationalized films in Hindi film history. It's one of the first major mainstream movies to focus on the subject of extramarital affairs. It is a romantic drama co-written, directed, and produced by Yash Chopra. The crux of the film is between the three characters. It's a love triangle with Amitabh Bachchan, his wife Shobha, played by Jaya Bachchan, and the other woman, Chandani, played by Rekha. So today's Silsila is considered to be more of a cult classic. In this film specifically, Rekha wore beautiful saris. She was groomed immaculately, and according to the author of 100 iconic Bollywood costumes, Rekha's berry-colored lips were all the rage at that time, but it is the way that the sari is portrayed with beauty and unique style and meaning that makes Silsila an important fashion film. Shobha was draped more loosely in her sari, whereas Chandni was draped to show off her sensuous curves. I think also if you are a fan of Bollywood films, you would know that the Yash Chopra leading lady is always immaculately dressed in a beautiful chiffon sari. This was kind of in keeping with that tradition. In an interview with Hindustan Times, Yash Chopra said, "Rekha and I worked hard on Silsila. For the songs, she used most of her own jewelry. Although Pamela Chopra, Yash Chopra's wife, Jennifer Kapoor and Lina Daru are officially credited with working on the film as costume designers, it seems that both the actress and the director were also very involved in the costumes for this film. Time to highlight the countless instances of Rekha using her own personal jewelry or wardrobe to realize a vision for the styling of the characters in her films. Throughout my research, there are so many instances, anecdotes and stories of Rekha assisting a director with wardrobe and jewelry for the characters that she is playing. As I mentioned in this video alone, she was a part of the styling process for Silsila, Umrajan, Khubsurat, and of course the Vogue Arabia photoshoot of 2023. I also wanted to highlight this particular story that I came across in the Yasser Usman book, and I think it sums up Rekha's dedication and her love of style and basically creating memorable characters. Savan Kumar is the director of the 1974 film Havas. I hope I'm saying that correctly. And he stated that he told Rekha that he envisioned her in a song for his movie. He also told her that he had to go with another actress because he did not have the budget for her. So Rekha, after listening to the song, loved the song and told him not to worry about money, and she performed the song in the film for free. She also used her own costume, wig and jewelry in the song, and in the book it said that the director never forgot this kind gesture. This is Rekha at 30. Utsav was not a commercially successful film, and it is based on ancient Sanskrit text. It follows the story of the temple dancer. The costumes in Utsav are some of the most beautiful I've ever seen. In Utsav, the layered temple jewelry and the outfits are so elevated. So there is a point of reference between this outfit and the outfit worn by Vijayanthimala in the 1960s Amrapali film, and of course the evolution of the sari today. Rekha's outfit in this film was so standout, and she was prominently featured on the film's posters in this outfit. In Ijazat, directed by Gulzar, Rekha plays Sudha and Nasiruddin Shah plays Mahendra, a divorced couple. Very clean cut look in this film. She has a bindi, large glasses, and as the story unfolds, we see that her character has many layers, as stated in the online article by S. Bengani for firstpost.com. On the surface, Gulzar designs Sudha much like the quintessential Indian wife, as was popular in the 1980s. Don't let Sudha's saris, red bindis, bangles, gaudy makeup, or her unassuming Desi vibe fool you. She may not ride bikes, smoke cigarettes, or wear chic Western clothes, but she is the only one in Ijazat with any real katsba. It may not appear like it, but if you look closely, despite Maya's loud claims, it is Sudha who calls all the shots in the film. If there's any Indian film that screams 1980s excess, it is this film. And her performance in this film won her a Filmfare Best Actress Award. The storyline of this film is quite outrageous. It's reportedly inspired by the Australian miniseries Return to Eden. There is 1980s inspiration. Rekha's outfits were totally inspired by Joan Collins, Dynasty. It was over the top excess. The film was released. The audiences actually applauded Rekha for the styles because the inspiration was taken from the top soap operas of the time that were popular. According to the book, 100 Iconic Bollywood Costumes, Rekha was involved in creating these looks and this character. As the editor of Harper's Bazaar India, Nonita Kalra, stated, "Nothing succeeds like excess in India, and Rekha epitomized it. Her film career was punctuated as much by her style as well as her performances. Every time Rekha transformed her style, it impacted her career because she understood the value of getting into character. She was a true chameleon." there were two films that will forever be remembered as her most maximalist film costumes. The first being Madam X, and in Khiladio Ka Khiladi. Khiladio Ka Khiladi, Rekha played a glamorous gangster. She used headwear in this film. Turbans, it gave her the diva brand image that she was definitely cultivating at this point. It was predominantly during this time in the 90s when Rekha decided to make a statement through her own extravagant photoshoots. Fashion photographer Jayesh S. said, "Rekha is the first one who started the personalized theme-based photoshoot fad in Bollywood. The camera loves her and she loves the camera." According to this photographer, Rekha loved experimenting with her look. She used to do her own hair, makeup, and costumes for these very glamorous photoshoots. According to this photographer who worked with Rekha for 12 years, they did a shoot practically every month. 1990 saw Rekha more on the covers of magazines than on the big screen. Gautam R., who took photographs of Rekha, once said, "Rekha is India's ultimate cover girl. She is extremely hardworking and takes a lot of pain over every single picture. No photograph of hers is a mistake. I think stars like her, who take so much trouble to be in the public eye, deserve to be loved and treated like legends." Rekha made a special appearance in a song in the film Paranita. It's pretty clear that Rekha has a soft spot for all things glamorous. Depicting a cabaret dancer in a Moulin Rouge style was a perfect fit for her. I loved seeing her in this special appearance and in her natural element in this film. In this song, she wore a red flamenco-style sari. The credited costume designer for this song and film was Shubharna Ray Chowdhury, and she said in an interview that cabaret singers of that time would have worn a gown, but Rekha wanted a sari, so we married the two for this sari gown. Red lips, black gloves, and a frilled petticoat made the look even more dramatic. Talk about Rekha and the Tavayev character and her connection to the Tavayev character. According to the Yasser Usman book, in many interviews, Rekha has said that she really feels a connection to these kinds of characters, meaning Tavayevs, courtesans, dancing girls, or the notch girl characters. And it's definitely understandable. She is an actress who started in the industry as a child and she had a turbulent love life, but she persevered through the many tragedies and the difficulties in her life. The depiction of the notch girl, the Tavayev, the dancing girl, or the courtesan is a particular archetype in Bollywood films, and it's been this way for many decades. Basically, the courtesan has a heart of gold, but she often ends up falling in love with the hero, but society would not allow them to be together. Despite being highly skilled artists and musicians and dancers and symbols of art and beauty, loneliness is the constant companion of the Tavayev or courtesan in a Bollywood movie. So the director of Umrao Jaan said that he cast Rekha in the role of Umrao Jaan based on photographs alone because, according to him, the striking feature of Rekha is that which draws from her past. Her eyes conveyed the experience of having been broken and then having pulled herself together. Life shakes up people. And if they have an artist within them, then she or he gets more polished in the process. Rekha is a living example of this. In films like Mukaddar Ka Sikandar as Zorabai, Utsav or Umrao Jaan, she has played this kind of role in numerous films, always maintained a partiality to play these roles or to depict these characters in songs. That's why I loved that in the Vogue Arabia 2023 issue, these pictures are definitely an ode to her love for these characters, and these images specifically reference this. We also see this in the behind the scenes video from the actual shoot, and I loved that this photo shoot was referencing the importance that these characters have played in her life and in her career. Let's discuss Rekha's amazing personal style. In the Vogue Arabia 2023 article, Rekha said, "I was born with an instinct for the perseverance of beauty. So Rekha's style in real life can definitely be described as a kind of South Indian glamorous eternal icon. Essentially, she has go-to looks for her events, and these include heritage saris, be it Banaras or Kanjivaram saris, a potli bag, her long hair either left open or styled into a bun with gajra, Indian jewelry, and her very iconic bold red lip. But her monotone looks with these elements are some of my favorite of her looks because they just look so luxurious. Let's discuss who or what really influences Rekha's personal style. Rekha has always stated that her South Indian roots and her mother, Pushpavali, are the major influences in her personal style. And she discusses this in this clip.
This is something very personal why I wear a Kanjivaram sari or saris for that matter. You want to know a secret?
Yes.
It's very personal, but you know, it's not private. So I guess I can impart this information. To me, style is just not something that is external. It's a feeling, you know. I wear saris because it's my tradition. It's my roots. It reminds me of my mother. And when I wear a Kanjivaram sari, I feel I'm engulfed with love, protection, and a lot of softness from my mother. So right now, this is what I'm feeling. She's right here. So if that is what is style, so be it. This is for you, Amma. Thank you for making me stylish.
So regarding her choice of wearing sindoor, which is usually worn by married Hindu women, she has always maintained in interviews that to her, she considers it fashionable and that's why she wears it. So let's discuss my top six Rekha looks. So at number six, I'm going to start with a very recent look. This is March 2023 in Mumbai. And this is Rekha at the Dior event in a white sari for Dior's India-inspired pre-fall collection. This event was set against the backdrop of the iconic Gateway of India. After meeting Rekha, the creative director at Christian Dior wrote about her experience on Instagram, and she wrote, "I was so touched to meet the iconic Rekha last night for the first time, India's most iconic woman and an incredible actress. I'm so grateful you have joined us last night. It was a true honor." This Instagram post kind of inspired the title of this YouTube video, Rekha the Icon. So at number five, I have this outfit, the Geo Filmfare Awards 2015. This was Rekha in 2015. She was wearing her trademark Kanjivaram sari in a royal blue shade. Also, what I loved about this look was the styling of her hair and the long sleeve blouse. At number four, Rekha in pink and red fits. This was December in 2018, and this was Rekha at Isha Ambani's wedding in a pink and orange Banarasi sari. The combination is the quintessential Rekha look. She added her statement traditional jewelry, a pink potli bag, and a bun adorned with flowers, and she has always looked great in shades of pink. She's worn it over the years many times. Another look that I loved in these particular shades was her regal look for the Dior show in 2023 in this reddish golden Kanjivaram sari for the event. At number three, it's Rekha in this particular shade of green. It's a particular shade of green that clearly Rekha is very fond of. She has worn it throughout the years, and I love it because it's so different from other shades of green that we kind of see very often. This was her at the NMAC opening gala in a similar shade with traditional jewelry. It's a Kanjivaram silk sari. She had a choker necklace, a mata pati earrings, bangles, bracelets, and rings. At number two, Rekha in her casual looks. So these are so underrated. We talk about Rekha and we associate her with these very kind of traditional outfits that she wears to events. But I do think that her casual out and about style is glamorous. She wears luxurious materials, scarves, head wraps, and statement glasses with, of course, her bold red lip. And one of my favorite moments was when she recently wore these sneakers with her sari. It's such off-duty glamour. Her kind of casual looks have a stylish, effortless, and cool vibe to them. My number one choice for Rekha is her in any gold or cream kind of combination. So for me, Rekha in a gold and cream look with bold red lips is iconic. She has worn this combination for many years at awards functions and various events. I think, however, from all of them, this is my favorite in particular. So my favorite Rekha look of all time. It was in 2018, and it was Rekha and Shah Rukh Khan at Sonam Kapoor's wedding reception. And this is one of my favorite pictures because it brings together two of my favorite Indian actors. But let's take a look at Rekha's outfit. I had to do some research into how exactly the sari was put together, and I found out here that Rekha is wearing a chakoshia. I hope I'm probably butchering that, but this is the spelling of it. A traditional ensemble that women wore during the Mughal period. And according to an online article on this topic by The Quint, the director of Erka Cultural Resources and Research, D. Sadhisaran, pointed out on social media the following. For all the fashion journalists going crazy at Rekha's pant sari, it's called a chagoshia, and this sartorial style is easily over 150 years old. It comprises a chow of four garments. A choli tight blouse, a kurti loose tunic, a tight pajama pants, and a 5-meter kada dupatta that's draped in a special way. The chagoshia is the traditional garment for women in Nizam's Hyderabad, incredibly stylish and still worn by women on their nikah or wedding ceremonies. We need fashion history schools. So this look was definitely special. You could just tell that there was something kind of different about it, and I'm glad that social media exists so we kind of know the history behind it. To sum up, Rekha has won Filmfare Awards, the Indian National Film Award, the Indian Padma Shri in 2010, and countless international awards. But I think more importantly, her cultural impact on Indian film and fashion history cannot be quantified. She has always been surrounded by controversy, but her phenomenal rise in an over-patriarchal industry deserves to be applauded. So the author Jerry Pinto, I think, sums up her journey best. She started by being a starlet. She went on to being a star. She then became an actor, a genuine actor, and then she became a diva. That's the video. I hope you guys have a very good rest of your day, and I will see you in the next video.